I gotta run, keep from hiding. I'm bound to keep on riding. And I got one more silver dollar. And I ain't gonna let them catch me, no. I ain't gonna let them catch the Midnight Rider.
Glad you could make it. You know, these are serious times. Best friend in the whole world, American Dream Dusty Rhodes, suspended from wrestling for the next 120 days. All because of an incident that was surrounding me. You know, I've always been a man to stand up on my own 2 feet, fight my own battles, and now I've been pushed into a situation that I can't control. I don't like having to rely on a baseball bat, a 2x4, or anything else. But Dusty Rhodes told me about the rider. He told me of your way and what you stand for. And I'm mighty glad you're here.
Well, Maggie May, let me tell you something. My name is the Midnight Rider. I come from Diablo Canyon, Colorado. This here, children, is Dos Diablos, the finest piece of horse flesh in the world. And it belongs to me. And now with the arrival of the Midnight Rider throughout this country, throughout your television land, Dusty Rhodes begins to get vengeance through the Midnight Rider and through Magnum T.A. Because in every arena that me and Diablo go and right into them beautiful buildings, Magnum T.A. will be by the side of the Midnight Rider. Business now be taken care of in public, if you will. The Midnight Rider and Dos Diablos and Magnum T.A. fills your screen now with violence like you've never seen before. All my little doggies, my little partners out there in television land, get ready for the coming of the Midnight Rider.
If there was a wrestling show, we'll watch it. Listen to the jokes as Matt and Nick discuss it. Baby oil and blow and blow.
White guys rapping.
Yeah.
Baby, that's what's happening.
Oil and blow.
And throw blow. Your hands in the air.
See, the difference is ours goes, you know, and the other one goes, yeah. That's the hi-hat. That's the difference there. Do you understand?
I'm still going to hang you off the balcony by your fucking legs until I get my money. It's this argument you're making right now.
And
it's
then
doing nothing for me.
20 to 30 years later down the road, you're going to kill a man with a vehicle and finally do 40 years in prison.
That happened recently, didn't it?
Yeah, just
last
Suge
week. Knight
yeah.
got arrested for killing somebody, and I was like, Suge Knight's not in jail?
Yeah,
I thought
no.
Suge Knight was always in jail.
No.
That was like his thing. That's what he was.
He killed a man with his car on the set of a low rent movie. And apparently the law was finally like, sir, that's a bit much. You've done it.
Got
now.
A good 3 decades of murdering behind you now.
Yeah.
It's time. We're, high time we put you behind bars.
We really have to pin this one on you on account of all the footage of you running that man over.
I hate to put you out, but our hands are tied. And
yeah.
Now your hands are going to be literally tied. As we take you to jail.
Mm-hmm. Until he goes into whatever cool prison he goes to. I'd like to find out.
Don't fuck with Death Row. That's one thing I know.
Yeah. Death Row is the label that pays me. Did you know that?
I did, yeah. This is more white guy rapping. We're just keeping it going.
Okay.
Keeping it going. Do you want to do some Mabel and Mo stuff? What kind of stuff are they doing out there?
Who?
Shaking your hands back and
Mo?
Forth and then on a mission.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I also like Public News, whatever, that rap and wrestler guy.
PN News?
Yeah, PN News. He was a good guy.
Yeah, he was. He's a classic.
That's right. He's a wrestler because this is the wrestling show, Baby Oil and Blow.
Don't you know?
With you, as always, the Big O. And who you gonna be this week? You can be Art Pritz to my big bear collie.
Ahoy, ahoy, everybody. It's pleased to be here and be representing Art Pritz.
Yeah.
I just noticed you've now added a...
What?
What is that? A Tom Zenk trading card to
Nate
my desk
Adams,
here?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm just looking over here and I see next to this little collection of what's detritus that you keep on adding to every week when you come over here. I now have our little Ric Flair figure seems to be holding up a Tom Zenk trading card.
That
the Z-Man.
Probably from Flair's own collection. That's why Flair's holding the card up.
He's a pretty man. So that's,
but if
is
I'm
that
familiar,
a rookie card right there?
If I'm familiar with that line of training card, or
what's that thing,
line of trading cards?
What's that
cards?
Thing go for in Beckett right now?
Oh,
what's it pricing out at?
Whoa, buddy. Well, the last WCW card Beckett that was printed in 92.
Okay.
He's dead now, so, you know,
the Z-Man?
Yeah, Z-Man died earlier this year.
He's so young and beautiful. How could he die?
Do yourself a favor. I was talking to Flair before the show over there.
You were?
Yeah. Don't judge. Check out the back of that card, and why don't you read to the listeners the Z-Man's quote.
Okay, what do we got here? The Z-Man, he's weighing in at 250 pounds. His motto, quote unquote, stay single, is what they're saying.
Boom!
I believe that. That's
that's pretty cool,
words
huh?
Words to live by right there. Tom Zenk, a.k.a. Z-Man, is not your average wrestler. He says, I'm starting at the bottom and working my way to the top. I don't care who has the belts.
He's a blue chipper.
Luger, Flair, I don't care who it is. I'm here to make a name for myself.
Yep.
And so far, it looks like he will. This former Mr. Minnesota, promises to be a strong contender. I gotta say, Mr. Minnesota.
Yeah.
Just they don't have very many physical specimens up there, so not too impressed. Not too impressed with that accolade.
But either way, stay single is the real takeaway from all that.
That's the new, I feel like, baby oil and blow mantra. We're going to have to start signing off with that at the end of that's it for baby oil and blow. You know, we say every week,
stay
single. Stay
single. I think so. Yeah. Thank
you.
You
guys don't need any women tying you down, man.
Yeah,
they're just holding you back.
Yeah.
You want to go out there as a man and you want to advance yourself in this world. You want to work on stuff like chopping wood and like communing with nature, like shit that like Brady Boone would do out in the woods of Oregon with all of his cousins.
And if there's anything I know about you, the listener, you're a wrestling fan, and you know you're probably crushing pussy.
Yeah,
like,
there's
left
women.
And right.
Oh, like, just like, ugh.
Oh, yeah.
What do you think about maybe if I got these shoes? What do you think maybe if my hair had bangs? And then you're like, I don't care.
Oh,
like,
you didn't watch UFC 229 on Saturday? You watched Super Showdown at like 2 in the morning? Oh, that's sexy as fuck.
Tell me
about that.
What sort of a straw man are we propping up the teardown right now?
Tell me about it, because I want to fuck you,
wrestling fan. This is a woman character you're doing who loves wrestling fans but hates dudes that watch UFC.
Yeah, that's not cool. Okay. But watching wrestling, that is cool. That's how you crush the poon, pal.
I was trying to do a little pep talk to all my still single gentlemen out there, and suddenly it went off.
No, they're supposed to stay single.
Yeah, they definitely need to stay single.
They're wrestling fans, and they can have whoever they want.
You can watch some UFC, though. Let's throw that in there. There was a big brawl at the UFC this week. It
was
very entertaining.
No charges are going to be filed, which leads me to believe that the whole shit was staged.
Absolutely.
And just
or is possibly they're just saving it for that Irish on Russian street justice a little bit later on. Like, don't press charges now.
That's cool.
Because we're going to have a knife fight a month from now.
Is that going to be televised?
I don't know if it's going to be in Siberia. I don't know if it's going to be in like the alleys of Dublin.
Well, I'd say it's got to be in Siberia for this to be legal.
I feel like this is turning into a whole Biggie Tupac type thing. Like, members of these camps are going to start dropping like flies, especially if Putin was watching this shit. He makes people disappear right and left.
Oh, that's a very good point.
Anybody friends with that loudmouth Irish guy? What's his fuck? Conor McGregor.
My two favorite...
I'd be watching behind me.
My two favorite parts of that melee were when Khabib does that jump kick. He, like, successfully jumps the cage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then he's on the little riser.
He looks like a lynx.
Yeah, he's on that little riser, and then he just, like, throws a jump kick at somebody in a...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
From
I think it was
McGregor's
Conor's trainer or something.
Which was
he
fucking
looked like
cool.
When you see a rat like get like a full parking lot's run so he can jump on the top of a dumpster.
Yeah.
Like that was the amazing leap
it
he did
cool.
off of that fucking cage. He looked like a human rat, everybody.
My other favorite part was when somebody in Khabib's camp like came up face to face with McGregor and was like, I'm gonna punch you in the face, but you could tell like he was super scared to throw hands with McGregor, but he was literally just distracting and killing time till old boy jumped the
old
fence.
Red shirt.
Yeah.
Like, And don't worry, I got him from behind.
Lit up McGregor from behind.
Four or five real quick, just yeah. back of his head, just straight up like shot in the back pew, over pew, a matter of pew, $10. Pew, pew, pew.
It was cool.
Buford Mad Dog Tannen style.
Yeah, it was really fucking cool.
There's a lesson we can learn from all of this. It's what I've been saying for years. Don't go anywhere near Russians. Those people yeah. are fucking animals.
Right. Yeah. I found this Russian dude's wallet.
Yeah.
On the streets of Chicago one time.
Instead of cash in it, it just was like strips of nylon from different windbreakers he had. Yeah, that's what too. They use at currency over there.
But he had many a card in there. He did have credit cards. He had like his bank card and mm-hmm. everything else.
Oh, he's got a card for that illegal massage parlor. I didn't yeah. know they gave out yeah. cards.
He had a ID and everything. So I was like, 2015 or 16, whatever it was when I found it. I was like, this guy's got fucking Facebook. Mm-hmm. So I get on there and I find the guy, right?
Okay.
Picture matches, name matches, and I message the guy. I'm like, hey, bro, you know, found your wallet. You know, I can return it to you or mail it to you. Just, you know, let me know.
Mm-hmm.
Motherfucker never gave it back to me. You know why?
He probably thought that whatever he was doing had been uncovered.
Right.
And he probably skipped the country.
He probably, Russia figured his cover was blown and just
That's
drug him out
possible.
Of the country.
Yeah, this could be a full as soon on as, just yeah. KGB agent type thing.
He probably dropped the wallet as they were throwing him into the van.
Mm-hmm. He was probably here as like a sleeper agent to try and like groom the like richest man in the area, which I have to assume is Papa, the old Greek man who owns Papa's Deli.
Oh, no,
he's the most longtime local celebrity.
That's fair. This was in the streets of Chicago, though. This is yeah.
still, he could have been here looking for Papa. Yeah. He could have just been like, I'm going to get here. I'm going to make friends with Papa. And then I'm going to, you know, get something on him. I'm going to make him owe me something. Or I'm going to get some footage of him doing something. And then we have the whole town.
He's just up and down the Mag Mile.
Where Papa goes the county. I've always said that, too.
Yeah, he's going up and down the Mag Mile with a picture of Papa's, like, mm-hmm. like in Terminator 2. And he's just like, where's the Papa's
have
Dilly?
Have you seen this man?
Have you seen this Papa's Dilly?
I assume
Dilly?
His name is probably George or Manoli.
Have you seen this Papa's Dilly? To no avail, so
yeah,
he got you know, time traveled back to Russia courtesy yeah. of a unmarked van.
If you get a DM from one of us on one of these social media things, get back at us. We yeah. might have important information for you.
Sergey, Vlad,
that's
whatever
the
you are
of the day.
Yeah, get a hold of us. You want to talk current wrestling?
What do you got? I figure that UFC stuff counted as our yeah. current wrestling.
There's the Super Show in
they're
Australia.
They're both just as fake as each other now. So, yeah. you know, you talk UFC, you basically
one
talk
the
wrestling.
Other. Yeah, welcome to the fold, UFC fans. You guys thought you were legit.
Finally. You guys figured out how to shoot a decent angle.
Right? Make people care.
Oh, did you see that double turn where Connor went into that
yeah.
fight, that big heel?
Oh, yeah, I'm a bad guy. I'm a good guy, you know.
Russians ganged up on him. Now he's got all this babyface sympathy from the crowd. He's got to come back and fight from
this
under now.
This was all orchestrated by Dana White so that they can finally have, now that McGregor's going to be a good guy, they mm-hmm. can have you two play McGregor to the ring.
Oh, it's been the dream for so long.
Yeah, that's why UFC was invented.
With Tommy Lee Jones in his corner.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
mm-hmm.
man, it's going to be...
Ooh, yeah.
I've never bought a pay-per-view in my life of any sorts.
Yeah, but
you know,
will for that
far
one.
Too expensive. But as soon as that shit happens, I'm yeah. plopping down my $80, $90, whatever the fuck they cost these days.
I'd just send them your whole wallet and let them figure it out.
Here you go,
and
Russians.
Just trust
just
them to
one for one. We got
you.
One of your wallets. Now you got one of ours.
Ooh, wow.
That's how it works.
You want to just review Blown Away right now?
We
don't even have to watch it. We could just go off.
Yeah,
the top
I feel
of
like
our
heads. I know enough about at least the Tommy Lee Jones parts of Blown Away to run them down pretty quickly.
All right, here's what we've got. We're being bombed.
Feds, you're coming up with zeros. Looks like our boy's a mystery man.
He's no mystery. His name's Ryan Garrity. According to the report, the guy can build bombs out of Bisquit.
I've come here to create a new country for you called Chaos, and a new government called Anarchy. All for you.
One yeah. of my favorite performances and one of my favorite movies of all time.
He's just the greatest man. The greatest.
Instead of that, though.
Jimmy Dore.
Let's skip over that.
No,
let's
I got a real wrestling.
Not talk about that super showdown
we're,
thing.
No, we're not.
Bring
I got
up.
Something better for you.
Who cares about that? What?
It's
what
a
is
big
it?
Announcement for the listeners. They okay. don't know yet. We didn't tell them. You ready?
I'm ready for it.
Ready? Listen to it. That's right. We're currently live podcasting from the third hour of Raw in Chicago, okay. Illinois.
Oh.
Yeah, that was the crowd you just heard.
That's very exciting.
Yep.
We're here live. Am I supposed to put in some crowd noise there?
No. No, the dead silence. It's the third hour of Raw. Get
oh,
it?
Oh, I get it.
It's a joke.
I was just waiting for you to like fart or something. No. Like, oh, he pulled one over on us again.
That'd be a pretty cool one,
though. Dirty old dog Matt.
We're just kidding, though. That dead silence was actually the crowd reaction to DX announcing that they're back this evening. That happened, Nate.
Can you be in DX when you're bald? Just two completely bald guys? It starts to look a little bit like a neo-Nazi group, doesn't it, at this point? Doesn't it start to look like some sort of skinhead gang?
Might have been why the crowd didn't do anything when they announced it.
Yeah, I don't know. You need to... Wherever Trump is holding his next rally, they should have waited for that and went there and done it in front of that crowd, announced the new DX, the new skinhead 60-year-old DX.
The whole promo was just a build-up to Triple H being like, we got off that plane, touchdown in Chicago, and I turned to Michaels and I said three words to him. And the crowd was just like,
yay.
That's the DX thing, right?
Oh, man.
And then they were like, no,
seriously.
We've
already had a few reunions of this.
But then they like laid into it like, no, seriously, we're doing DX again.
No, you guys are way too old the last time. I'm not so sure it's a good idea.
That's nice.
Where's Road Dog?
Yeah, that's the only one of them I want to see.
Does that, I wonder if he gets through that shaky knee thing here in his old age.
Or Billy Gunn, he's still in great shape.
The badass, he's one of the best pure athletes in wrestling history. JR told me that so many times. But then he was never able to use that athleticism to be a very good wrestler.
No.
That was a shame. Yeah, okay, DX is back. Now they're going to have a big tag match with The Undertaker and Kane.
In Saudi Arabia.
Combined age of 240 in the ring. And
roughly.
Wow, they got those big TV deals. Now they're just turning into retirement league wrestling, I guess. Just bring all the old guys out here and let them put on some exhibition matches.
We, kind of...
Remember back when wrestling was in the zeitgeist?
Yeah, we kind of unintentionally alluded to it a week ago when you and I started talking about the new blood. But that's what it's turning into.
Mm-hmm. It's time to bring back Vince Russo, bring back Billy Kidman, get that new blood thing going.
I don't know how H escapes the Billionaires Club and ends up in the New Blood, but it happens.
He'll find a way.
He'll find a way.
Life finds a way. Triple H finds a way.
Since we're at the sweet live wrestling event.
So, yeah, I
Should
feel
we
like
talk wrestling?
We've got the same moral of the week as we do every week as we go through live wrestling, modern wrestling news. We've reached the same conclusion.
Somebody kill me.
No reason to watch modern wrestling. Yeah. So, there we go. Right. Now, let's get into 1980s wrestling. The golden years of wrestling, I feel like it was. The golden age. This week, we're doing a rundown of WCW from April 9th, 1988. What's it going to be brought to? Columbo. One of those made-for-TV Columbo movies 20 years after that show is over.
I feel
like old people like watching that stuff.
I thought you were going to say Columbus Day.
Today's Columbus Day and I'm Columbo.
I'm Columbo.
You hear me?
Hey. Oh, man, that's a great TV spot. That's like a USA thing. Like, this Monday on USA.
USA's all about character.
Columbo's Day. Join us for your five favorite episodes back to back to back to back to back.
I would watch the fuck out of that.
Instead, I watched this episode of World Championship Wrestling.
And like the last one and the one before that, it was a real kick in the dick getting through it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's run down what happened.
It was not my favorite Columbo's Day.
The Fantastics, they're in there in our first match against the previously mentioned Art Pritz and Big Bear Collie. They win with their fantastic rocket launcher. Didn't look so good because Fulton isn't even really tall enough to be the bottom of this move.
No.
Pretty much he just put his hands up and then Rogers jumped, and then when Rogers was in the air, he just flicked his dick a little bit.
They do the free willy thing, really.
Yeah, but he made contact with the head of his dick. Like, I took it back and I watched it again slow and I was like, did he even touch him at all? And I was like, oh no, he flicked his dick head. So
you can see it move.
That's adding a lot of extra oomph to that top rope splash. Some sort of punishment for something I did in a last life must be, because they've put Larry Zbysko and Al Perez together as a tag team.
Against a even better tag team.
They're in there against Ricky Santana and Tommy Angel.
Oh, two guys that are in two different tag teams?
Yeah, very scintillating matchup we've been given here. This is all build up to the Crockett Cup, which once again, everybody cares about so deeply. Fine. Perez wins with a spinning toe hold. If I didn't say that already, who could tell? Dr. Death, he's in there versus Alan Martin.
Yeah. That's Chris Martin's father.
Okay, yeah. For the record. This is why Chris Martin was able to write so many sad songs. His dad died in the ring after he was power slammed by Dr. Death Steve Williams.
He also looks like a scrawny version of the Cheers Frasier.
Sammy, you're too old to go on a date with two twins on the same night you're supposed to marry Diane without Rebecca knowing.
Okay, Carl, I'll make you a bet. If this affects my major league comeback, I'll sell the bar.
Woody, give me a beer.
I think you've had enough, Mr. Peterson. My chiropractor says I can't carry you home anymore.
Just give me another beer, you brain dead hick. I'll kill you. I'll kill all of you.
Oh. Whoa, settle down, Nami. Oh. Gotta save those pipes for karaoke.
I love you guys.
Oh, okay, yeah. Slightly scruffier, younger Frazier.
Mm-hmm.
Nikita Koloff, he's in there versus, I said, Ryan Wagner, question mark? Because,
yeah.
I don't know, I looked away for a second.
No, that's who it was. Yeah, it was Ryan Wagner.
I thought so, but I wasn't totally sure.
That's Dr. Wagner's cousin.
What I was sure about is that Koloff was going to win with that Russian sickle. And then he did. And then he cut a promo. And every year, his Russian accent gets worse and worse.
Yeah.
I couldn't understand a single goddamn word of his promo.
No, none of it.
Arn Tully are in there versus Kendall Windham of the Windham family and his tag team partner, jumping old man Mike Jackson. And,
yep.
Great tag team there, but, you know, they're not able to put it together. Double A gets the pin with a brain buster on Jackson. Horsemen go over. Sting's in there versus the masked man named the Destroyer. You know the drill. Big splash. Scorpion Deathlock. Sting wins.
I thought Destroyer was going to pull this one out. I really did.
I thought he was due. Ron Garvin is in there versus a guy named Bob Emery. He wins in about 2 seconds with a punch to the face.
His grandfather created the Emery board.
Good to know. Okay, Varsity Club. They're in there versus El Negro and Tony Bowen.
Mm-hmm.
Varsity Club wins. I don't know. I saw a beautiful rotunda suplex for sure. And I think like Sullivan got in there and dropped a knee or something.
No,
he
did.
It's
just like
on it. I don't know.
Stupid little double stomp.
I looked away and then it was over. Like
it was
the
a
theme,
double stomp.
The theme of this episode was every time I looked down to write like down who was wrestling in the match was already over. Like I heard a bell ring and I was
except
like,
except for a couple of them.
I just looked down for 2 seconds to write who was in the match and it's fucking over. What was the point of even having the match?
Mm-hmm.
One more, Dick Murdoch and the Powers of Pain in there versus Larry Davis, the Italian Stallion, and Tony Suber. Captain Redneck wins the match. With a brainbuster. Hallelujah. Show's over.
I really thought it would be funny that if it was Larry David in the match.
Mm-hmm.
And looking back at my notes now, I realize that I wrote Larry David.
Okay. Yeah.
That's on me.
Captain Redneck's just like, I don't know, making Nazi salutes. Some nice black family in the front row. Larry David's just standing there, awkward in between them, pulling at his collar, like,
Pretty.
Yeah, good pretty ending good. For this show. Unfortunately, that's not the ending we got. Let's get into our five count and dig a little deeper into this episode of television.
Okay, I'm up first.
Mm-hmm.
I have hated the Atlanta Braves for a very, very long time. Growing up a young Chicago sports team fan.
Sure.
Sons of bitches stole away Greg Maddux from the Cubs.
Oh, no.
They were just ran roughshod over the, you know, entire National League throughout all the 90s.
You don't appreciate that they celebrate the proud heritage of our native people, though?
Yeah, they do that. Whoa, and they do like the
they
chop
do that
thing. Oh, yeah,
they
do
that. I
thought
they only did that shit in Florida.
No. They do that in Atlanta.
It's offensive, Atlanta. Jesus Christ.
There's just a lot of things about the Braves that
hashtag
I've always...
We three.
Hated. But this week, my first and number one thumbs up goes to the Atlanta Braves, because thank you to them losing 5-3 to the LA Dodgers in an afternoon game.
You're going deep here.
On April 9th, 1988, they took a half hour away from NWA's WCW.
Is this show
and we only sat through 1 hour and 5 minutes, because instead of a 2 hour show, it was a 90-minute truncated episode. Late,
and I was so drunk when I watched this that I didn't even realize I was getting a treat. I wish I was paying a little bit more attention.
Well,
I could have been like, wow, I really flew right, because it didn't seem shorter to me.
Here's the thing.
It seemed like a chore.
I'm going to turn one of the things you hate, or most people hate, into something you're going to like.
Oh, okay.
What's a lot of...
You're like the modern day Jesus of podcasting.
Yeah. One of the big complaints people have, especially my girlfriend with the baseball season, it's way too long.
Oh, yeah. They have
it goes
way too
on
many meaningless
forever.
Games. They have a game like every single day. Why?
So every couple of weeks, I check the head, Nate. We're going to get hour-long episodes.
Atlanta Braves are starting to knock these people down all the fucking time.
Ted Turner has shown where his allegiance is, and it's not to wrestling.
Pretty exciting.
It's his baseball team. So every couple of weeks, instead of sitting through an hour and a half straight of wrestling, we're only going to have to watch an hour of it. There's one.
God, I feel like they put on as many matches as usual. Why?
Nate.
Their approach is gonna keep ruining this.
There's one I looked ahead that has a runtime 55 minutes.
That's going to be like a day off right there.
Are you excited or what?
I'm going to put my feet up, I think, when I'm watching that one.
Yeah.
Make myself a cool drink.
So poo-poo for all my life, Atlanta Braves. But this year, this day, whatever, cheers.
It's a beautiful day.
Yeah, cue it up.
Here comes Conor McGregor.
Yeah, we're high-fiving as Bono's.
Conor McGregor and Triple H are walking down with Tommy Lee Jones. They're all here to get their revenge on the Russians.
Ooh, is H doing that?
Probably, because
he
started doing that as soon as he saw that Nikita Koloff has gone back to the Russians, and he's in the corner.
Oh, snap.
He's in the opposite corner.
Who's that Russian they had on SmackDown a couple years ago?
Vladimir Kozlov?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, he was pretty good.
He had a nice little run in Mexico.
Did he?
After the E kicked
him
out.
What, like running drugs or?
No, CML like, or AAA.
Selling tickets to donkey shows?
Yeah, he was doing like comedy shit in AAA.
Oh,
he was
good.
Pretty good.
He learned from the greatest, Santino Marella.
Oh, it's true. One of the best.
One of my last memories of watching wrestling, I think. I think around the Santino Marella and Kozlov teaming up, I was finally just like, I can't watch any of this anymore, man. I gotta never watch this again. This is a big waste of my time.
Which translates to this guy. This is not my guy.
No, not my guy.
So that was my number one.
Okay.
You didn't even realize.
No. Because like I said,
you're pumped now,
aren't
you?
They had as many different matches as they normally do. So they just all went like 20 seconds shorter, right. So it still felt like I was sitting through the whole goddamn show. Yeah. How about you have less matches if you got less time, you big dumb idiots? My number one is just I was watching that Dr. Death match, that Dr. Death squash, and he was in there. JR's putting over what a big, just lumbering hunk of a man he is, which is true.
I gotta be honest with you, Shivani, just looking at him makes my dick hard.
He looks like the Monster House or something. He looks like a man who's a house.
That's
like,
pretty cool.
How do you even attack that guy? He's so big and thick.
Are you talking about the hit Robert Zemeckis film, or are you talking about...
I was talking about that cartoon that Dan Harmon wrote. I don't know if Robert Zemeckis has anything to do with it.
Dan Harmon wrote that?
Oh, yeah.
That cartoon movie?
Uh-huh.
Oh,
big
yeah.
Big time.
Zemeckis, I think, made it.
Wow, that's a big pedigree behind the Monster House.
Yeah. I didn't know if you were talking about that or if you were talking about the Discovery Channel television show.
That sounds good.
Where, like, people turn their houses into jokes.
Oh, God. Not interested in that.
Yeah.
My point, when I was watching this and listening to JR putting over what an impressive physical specimen this guy is, I was like, yeah, he really is, JR, but... Doesn't matter how impressive he is physically, much like Billy Gunn, the greatest athlete in the WWF, he's super boring to watch, so he's never going to get over.
Yeah.
I realize in that moment what Dr. Death is. He's Jim Duggan if Jim Duggan had zero personality.
Oh.
Essentially, 100%. They're exactly the same. They're the 100%. Exact same wrestler, only Jim Duggan has a bunch of personality.
And
so, wrestling doesn't need you, Dr. Death.
And the boner.
Go away. We got Jim Duggan. He's got a board. He's got a boner. He's usually got a booger coming out of his nose. He's my pick to click when it comes to big stomping around burly idiots.
Board, boner, and booger. Put that on a fucking shirt. Board, boner, and booger. The Jim Duggan
Jim
way.
Jim Duggan hasn't started selling that as a shirt already. Like, shame on him, first of all. Second of all, free idea, man. Get yourself some health care. I know you're a cancer survivor.
Yeah. I like those loose blue trunks. Really showed off his wiener flopping around.
It sure did.
Oh, well. C'est la vie, which is French for the la vie.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I had to go far for my next one.
That's lobby.
It was Animal. Trying to give a promo.
One half of the Road Warriors.
And this has happened before in their stupid studio because it's so small and formulaic week in and week out.
Sure.
Instead of just having a pre-taped interview with Animal, they had him do it.
I bet he'd thrive in that environment.
In the same exact set. Where 20 feet away, Mr. Koloff, Nikita Koloff, was making his first return match and was standing in the ring waiting for his time. And so the crowd's cheering wildly for Koloff, and you can't hear anything Animal saying.
Animal's trying to talk.
Because people are just screaming unexplainably.
Not being able to hear anything that's going on was a theme for me this episode. I was thinking about maybe getting into that a little bit later.
Yeah.
So technical difficulties is going on here. The nuts and bolts of putting together a TV show.
Yeah.
This many years into it, you're still not very good at it, Jim Crockett Promotions.
I just can't believe, you know, Nikita Koloff, clearly one of their bigger faces they have at the moment.
Oh, it's because everybody loves his promos so much.
And they're bringing him back.
It's This is how the Russians suck. Hulk Hogan.
Has the guy literally, like, never heard a Russian talk in his life?
I don't know. I need to go back and watch that episode of Wife Swap that he was on.
He needs to, like, go back and watch some fucking, what is that, Red Heat with Jim Belushi?
Ooh, yeah.
Like, learn about Russia a little bit.
Schwarzenegger?
Yeah, that was a good movie.
Hello.
Of your era, Nikita.
I'm from Russia.
When you're, like, out it's there on your own, you're feeling a little,
it's very good
a
to
little
see
lost,
you.
A little confused. You're not quite sure what to do.
I always say,
look to Jim Belushi, man. He's going to have something in his oeuvre that's going to help you out, going to give you what you need. In this case, it's that movie Red Heat. Just watch it and learn what Russians sound like.
Whenever I'm feeling down,
mm-hmm.
I just turn on K-9.
Yeah. Ask yourself WWJBD and watch some K-9. My number two,
yeah,
I think is where I am. Is talking about that hearing they had to see if Dusty Rhodes
was pretty cool, huh?
He said he was suspended. My whole point of it is how hilarious, like, the editing
was. I don't care if I'm
was,
suspended.
Because they really, this is like a, like you were saying, they don't do like pre-taped things, but this one they did. And they really went to town in the editing room.
Yeah.
They had reaction shots from everybody on the queue. And they were just rapid fire, just going through reaction shot from this guy, reaction shot
Ooh,
from this
I'm
guy.
Upset.
And everybody
Ooh,
was
I'm
just
happy.
Doing real cartoony acting, like fucking J.J. Dillon's like licking his lips and twiddling his fingers like a old fucking railroad tycoon.
That's pretty cool.
Just a lot of old white guys in a room who can't act being asked to act just over the top and just rapid fire editing, like I'm watching like fucking early 90s MTV, quite frankly. And it was great until they ended it with Tony Schiavone doing interviews with Paul Bosch and Jim Crockett.
Hey, what do you think about what
it's always one of their fallbacks that every time I'm starting
what
to like what they're doing,
they
always fall back on
their I'm Tony Schiavone.
Wrong-headed idea.
Hey,
that,
it's me, Tony Schiavone.
Nothing
what do you think about
for
what
better
you just
TV than white guys who work in an office being asked dry questions in an interview scenario.
Unless it, well, that worked for the show The Office.
I guess that's true.
Yeah.
And they had a pretty diverse cast.
So everybody's
Stanley
saying,
was a black gentleman.
Everybody's saying Steve Carell ripped off, what's his face, that limey.
Oscar was a Hispanic.
Yeah, what was the limey's name?
David
Brent. Everybody's saying Steve Carell ripped off David Brent.
Everybody says that.
But clearly, Dave Brent just ripped off the WCW board of directors.
And he ripped off Penn and Teller, like talking about atheism and stuff all the time.
Yeah,
I like he doesn't have any more fans. Pretty cool guys, especially that little one who doesn't talk.
That's a good bit.
Mm-hmm.
He got rich off that. Well, mm-hmm. He knows magic, too. I guess that's the other side of that coin.
The flying and the magic.
What do we got here? The Midnight Rider versus Magnum TA.
Rider.
You know, just...
Okay, let's get into it, because this is...
Dive right in there.
The bulk of the episode, dealing with the Midnight Rider.
Yeah.
So... 10 seconds after we learn that Dusty has been suspended for 4 months for hitting everybody with baseball bats a couple weeks ago, this is the pacing of their storytelling. We get a video of a new debuting wrestler.
New debuting wrestler.
Stop me if you've heard this one before. It's the Midnight Rider. He's a cowboy who's masked. He's a fat guy with a lisp and a splotch on his belly.
How do you know?
And he's sitting next to Magnum TA at a fire.
He, first of all, had a shirt on. So you don't know if he's got a splotch or not.
It was seeping through. That splotch
and
seeps,
second of
man.
All, there's no way you heard a lisp over that loud, piped-in stock country music they were playing to cover up the Midnight Rider to which they had no rights
to. Technical difficulties. They got some terrible, just, you know, universal access, not owned by anybody, generic country-sounding thing going, playing over... Magnum and the Midnight Rider in a mask saying very important things about how there's this new big main event wrestler coming, and you can't hear a single goddamn word they're saying because this unnecessary music. And what I figured was, this is not in the studio. It's not even a pre-tape backstage in the studio. They're out in the woods. They're by a fucking fire pit. So I figure... just none of their mics picked up anything of what they were saying.
All right.
And they're too stupid to do any ADR.
I'm going
to
fix it.
So they got all the footage back, and they're like, you can't hear what they're saying. What are we going to do?
Hold on.
We'll just play it anyways, and we'll play a song over it so you can't hear them. It'll seem like an accident.
This one isn't WCW's fault.
That's my theory. Okay, well, let's hear it.
So the original promo, which I've seen and heard clearly, is Magnum TA and... I almost said Dust. It's not Dust. It's Midnight Rider.
Uh-huh.
They're sitting next to each other.
They certainly are.
Midnight Rider, who we all know, comes from Diablo Canyon, Colorado.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
He probably would have told me that, but all I could hear was the twanging of that synth-sounding faux country.
The reason that that's all you could hear was because in the original...
Oh, they actually play the real song?
Doodle-ding-ding-ding-ding.
Okay, so it's a WWE Network problem. Where they can't be playing that licensed music, so they've picked some sort of Jimmy Hart penned nothing and done their best to turn the volume down on it completely.
Yeah.
Fuck that.
Yeah, so that was a victim of WWE editing.
WWE meddling. Pay the money for it or excise the episode, Vince. You gotta make the hard decisions. Enough of this compromise.
Yeah. You know, like, come on. Like, you wouldn't have to pay them too much to get the rights to that. I feel like they would have sold.
Or just throw it up there, and who's going to fucking notice that one buried episode of WCW television from 1988 on your streaming service has 30 seconds of a licensed song playing on it? Come on. Don't ask for permission. Ask for forgiveness, Vince. You used to have some balls.
Pay for it later.
What happened to those McMahon grapefruits?
Like, you could just be like, all right, how much to make this go away?
Oh, we've got a publicly traded company now, pal. I got to listen to the suits. You know how it is. No, fuck that. Yeah. Fuck that, it's motherfucker.
It's a shame, though, because it's a pretty great promo as far as promos go in wrestling history. Because Magnum's just, like, intense as fuck, and he's just like, every stadium I go to, I'm going to have this baseball bat. I'm going to have this guy with me right here. And he's like, I'm going to tell you something right now. I'm this man you ain't never seen or heard of in your life, daddy.
So much better than what I saw
when I
watched that. I
got this wrestling mask. I'm from Diablo Canyon, Colorado. I got my horse, Diablo, that rides along with me, if you feel me.
That's a pretty big coincidence that he's from the same place his horse is named. I wonder how that... panned out.
He magically found him. This is a bad dude. I don't know if you're listening to all these bad guys later.
Okay,
this is
so a bad dude. My number three is basically the number one rule we made for WCW and WCW wrestlers, which is, I tell you what, Daddy, if at any time Poochie is not on the episode, yeah, all the other wrestlers need to be asking,
Hey,
where's Poochie? Where's Big Dust? So the entire rest of this episode, all it is a backdrop for people to talk about the Midnight Rider. Yeah. And it's so dumb how they do it. Every single person addresses it in a completely different way.
Right.
There's no uniform decision of how they're handling it. Just the maybe the most idiotic thing,
but they're all,
is that the announcers are just no selling that they don't, yeah, know who this fat,
okay,
guy with
go,
a lisp with a mask is. They're just like, wow, a new wrestler, that's amazing.
No, he's a new guy.
And then 2 seconds later, they got JJ Dillon, who's like talking, and he's like, okay, we all know that this is Dusty Rhodes, so okay, that makes some sense. And it's like, well, that's what everybody should be doing. The heels should be mad. They should be incredulous.
Right.
This is Dusty Rhodes. Everybody knows that. There's no way he can wrestle under a mask.
Right.
The announcer should be like, hey, you've got no proof that it's Dusty Rhodes.
Yeah, don't just be like, no,
it's
man,
fun. He's found a loophole, maybe. Like, that's going to get under the skin of the bad guys. But instead, the announcers have to play total fucking idiots and act like they don't know. Then you got Kevin Sullivan showing up, going into business for himself, cutting promos like the Midnight Rider is some sort of alternate persona that Dusty Rhodes goes into that's way more dangerous than the regular Dusty Rhodes.
That's
and he's totally intimidated that now he has to deal with the Midnight Rider, which is the opposite of how J.J. Dillon reacted, where he's just like, come on, Dusty Rhodes, this is a travesty.
That's because 5 years previous to this, Sullivan was feuding with the Midnight Rider down in,
sure,
Florida.
Sure.
He knows
but
the brutality.
But they're not playing it. Nobody else is playing into that history. And also,
Kevin Sullivan is a purist.
What's the story,
sir,
we're telling here? Everybody, you want to, yeah, talk about how Vince micromanages everybody's promos?
Yeah.
At least everybody's on the same page. You know what they're shooting for with the storyline. You know,
yeah,
you're trying to be reacting to it. Everybody else is reacting to this story in a completely different way, putting it over in a completely different way. So as an audience, we have no idea what we're supposed to think about it. It's ridiculous. Fucking Dick Murdoch, the end of the show, is the last guy to comment. I mean, he's like, I don't care, it's just Dusty Rhodes. I'm going to whoop his ass like I would anyways.
I'm nefarious.
And I was just like, finally, a sane reaction to Dusty Rhodes showing up 10 seconds after he's suspended. And also, come on, you suspend Dusty this episode, you milk a little bit of tension out of,
yeah,
Dusty Rhodes being suspended and be like,
no,
oh, what's going to happen? How are we going to have wrestling without Dusty?
No,
and
off.
Then a couple weeks from now, you have him show up as the Midnight Rider, all cheeky. It was literally from one segment into the next. Jesus Christ, there's no storytelling on this show.
If they would have broadcast that he wasn't going to be there, no one would have showed up the next week, man.
They fucking taped these things like 18 at a time. What,
that's,
do you mean,
fair,
nobody would have showed up? It's,
that's
all the,
fair,
same thing.
Maybe they were, they didn't do it right, and this was their last week, and it was like, oh, shit.
It's
this
also,
is our tape week.
I'm starting to get one of those migraines right at the top front of my head where it just feels like Freddy Krueger's massaging my temples.
That's pretty cool.
Every second is just digging in a little bit deeper the more and more I think about this stupid fucking Midnight Rider story, which, like I said, on its head, if you deal with it right, you got everybody on the same page of how they're selling it. The heels are mad that Dusty got one over on them. The good guy announcers are being cheeky and being like, oh, we can't prove that it's Dusty. It's not a terrible storyline.
No.
It's just how they're doing it,
right,
is a total fucking mess. Like everything they do.
You were talking about just things not making sense and... Mm. I want to go to my next point, and that point is,
mm-hmm,
ta-hee-hee, ta-hey-hey.
That's a good point.
That's Ronnie Garvin talk,
mm-hmm,
which you people don't know about.
Shout out to Ron.
Did you catch any of this in the Sting promo?
No.
Oh, yeah. After he wrestled.
The thing I heard was Sting yelling about how if he wins the $1 million, he's going to throw a big party with
the
money.
Hillbillies in
the
audience.
And I was like, that's such a fucking Beastie Boy thing to say right there.
Yeah, he's a Beastie Boy.
I know.
Well, he's going on about
GR was right,
how he's going to be tagging with Ronnie Garvin. And Ross
what
asks
a dream
him,
come true for
Ross
Sting.
Ross asks him about it, and he responds with, ta-hee-hee, ta-hey-hey. You guys don't know what that is. You'll find out later. That's Ronnie Garvin talk. So apparently that's some kind of thing that Garvin used to say in the back.
Sounds like some sort of ribbon Ronnie Garvin live on air. Inside joke that nobody gets.
Hey. Ronnie Garvin's cool.
He's a weird old man. I don't get him.
This was one of my favorite Sting promos because...
I liked it too.
They hadn't done this in weeks, but finally they gave him too much time again.
Mm-hmm.
And when Sting has too much time to fill, he starts grasping.
No, I loved it. I feel like he's totally in control at this point. All he was doing was just having enthusiasm, yelling about throwing parties.
Right.
And everybody was with him all the way through.
Yeah.
There was at no point that he lost the audience.
One of my most favorite parts was when he's talking about how when he parties, he drinks champagne.
Mm-hmm.
But when J.J. Dillon parties, J.J.
Yeah.
Dillon drinks Ripple.
Who is he drinking Ripple? What
cases
a, what
of Ripple.
An idiot.
Now, that was Fred Sanford's drink of choice.
Absolutely.
Those that aren't familiar, it is a...
Fred Sanford was a character on a TV show for all you young folks out... For all you Bullet Club fans out there.
Mr. Sanford, you are going to enjoy this. It is called sangria.
Sangria? Say, what does sangria mean?
It means blood. It is only a name because of the color.
Oh, I thought it was something he brought back from the buffet.
No. It is a very popular drink. Do you like it?
Yeah, it tastes good.
Uh-huh.
It tastes like Ripple that's gone flat. In fact, they should call it Flapple. Hey, what's that stuff down there in the bottom?
Oh, that is fruit.
Look like garbage.
Champagne plus Ripple equals Champipple, which is one of Fred's favorite things. But it was up there with a Boone's
this
Farm.
This is a big one.
They sold it in pink and I think red, two flavors.
It wasn't a grape?
Nah,
a
I don't
purple
think
drink?
So. Nah, I don't think so. But it was known as the Bum's Wine of Bum Wines.
Yeah. I don't know. Sting was very casual here, very comfortable. He just kept interrupting the interviewer, just shrugging off questions he didn't want to answer.
He called him Rossi, which is pretty good.
I love how he just comes out there just like he's the fucking guy and he owns the shit. And that's why
he
went straight to the top. Don't talk about it, be about it.
And I like him just for that.
My number four is I just wanted to say that Stan Lane's outfit on this episode of television.
Yeah,
was
I almost
level.
Put that in there.
It was just next level. This guy came out.
He was ready.
Fucking great. Just purple tinted aviator shades.
Those glasses were the coolest.
A like black button up, totally unbuttoned other than like the bottom one.
What was a coat?
It had like some pink and purple, like Miami Vice looking accents on it.
Yeah,
like
that was
around.
Just a coat that he was wearing with no
full
shirt underneath.
Full on gold chain with gold medallion over chest hair. Like, this guy is just a legend. He's playing the blonde bimbo role better than anybody else. Just looking good, feeling good, and letting everybody know it. He's kind of just like my guru right now, my fashion guru. That's what I'm going for. I'm shooting for a Stan Lane this fall.
That would be nice for you. Just coats with no shirts underneath.
Gotta go get some hair bleach after this.
Do a little sunning.
Doing it. Yeah, I'm finally going for it.
Yeah, that's going to be nice.
This big old mop of mine's going bleach blonde. I have a whole Kurt Hennig thing going on top of my head.
I'm going to also bleach my hair and then thin out the middle of it, top middle of it, and then just kind of comb my bangs forward.
Oh, that'll be a nice little Arn Anderson circa 1988 look you got going on.
I got some chest hair. Not enough, though. I'm going to have to step that up if I'm going to go full Arn here, you know?
We'll figure out a way. We'll call a doctor.
I got a...
You got more?
Yeah, my final point
okay.
was that Ron Garvin versus Bob Emery match, which was a Luthes press into a right hand for a 1-2-3 for a total of like 10 seconds.
Yeah, what do you want to say about this match?
Why the fuck wasn't that the Dr. Death Steve Williams match or the Nikita Koloff match? Both of those guys sold jobber offense at one point or another in those matches. They're returning characters. They're reestablishing these characters. Why didn't they just win in 10 seconds like Ronnie Garvin?
Ronnie Garvin's a former NWA champion. Beat the Nature Boy Ric Flair, so He's a little bit higher on the totem pole.
I'm just saying, Ronnie Garvin was the only one that had the right idea. He's like, I'm just going to go out there, I'm doing two moves, and I'm collecting a check.
Rare tool time salute to Ronnie Garvin.
To Ronnie.
We're giving you this episode.
Ronnie
for
Garvin.
Keeping his match that we don't want to see short.
Yeah.
God bless you, Ronnie Garvin.
God bless.
My last point is just another audio issue. What the fuck was going on with the varsity club's entrance?
With the fake claps?
They come out. I couldn't tell if it was the sound of popcorn popping for a long time.
Yeah.
And then I figured out that it was like the sound of fake claps, but it was just a... It's just a lot of, I don't even know what, but just, once again, it was like that Midnight Rider where it was just playing over the audio of everything else. It's just like, I don't know, maybe like a clip of fake-generated audience applause playing over.
It wasn't like, here's...
What would be the point of this? They're not trying to get the varsity club over his faces people are popping for him. Like, is it just supposed to be the ambient noises of like a... college football game, maybe?
It was,
what point? That's a very weird, heady idea to try and use to get somebody's entrance over. Like, what the fuck was going on with that audio?
It was really weird because it wasn't like, oh, my favorite wrestler's coming out applause. It was like somebody's giving a speech polite applause.
Like, I literally thought fucking old JR and Tony had some Jiffy Pop going next to their mics or something.
Hey,
like,
you gotta excuse me, fans.
Guys, that's not very professional.
Hey, you gotta excuse me. I'm hungry. Got my Jiffy Pop. Tony Schiavone also likes Jiffy Pop. Careful, don't burn yourself out of the stove there, JR.
It could have been a sponsorship thing gone awry. They never quite, because the match was so short, they never quite got to go into their Jiffy Pop spiel. So,
just
the dollars left on the table there. Either way. Yeah.
It was
a bunch
weird.
Of weird audio shit all
I never
throughout
noticed
this episode.
The applause in any of the other episodes.
It's either new or a mistake.
Yeah,
either
way,
I don't
know
what it is or why it is.
It was all
I don't
weird.
Like it. I
and
don't
you know
like
what?
It.
We just summed up NWA WCW. It's weird. I don't understand it, and I don't like it.
It's either something they were trying or a mistake, or I don't know what, but I don't like it.
Well, we're going to wash away this mistake by making a couple dollars while you listen to these commercials.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
When I came to America from Russia, I discovered many wonderful things like blue jeans, unopened mail, and light beer from Miller. Yeah. When I tasted this light, I said to myself, what a country. Light has great taste. Light's also less filling with third less calories than the regular beer. In America, there is plenty of light beer and you can always find a party. In Russia, party always finds you.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
When first I become citizen, I studied American culture very closely. Hey, score touchdown for me, big guy. Now I'm expert on all things American, except gasoline. But I don't need to know about gasoline. My car knows. What a country.
Amoco Ultimate, rated the best gasoline you can buy.
In Russia, cars also know, but they can't say.
I was just, sometimes I do the songs, you know. If I get a good three count one, I'll think about it, or I'll do it, or whatever.
The last couple, I've cut out the songs in editing, because I felt there was like a better just like sneak into it point.
Yeah.
And then, like, I've learned, like, we don't always have to do the song.
No.
It doesn't have to like be a thing that we feel like we always have to lean on.
Yeah, get off my nuts, you know? Like,
Jesus Christ.
I work hard enough, people. Like, you know, I give you one at the top of the show pretty much every week, so that should be good enough.
Yeah. Oh God, you're already going into the Rick Sanchez burps. This is going to be a
what do you mean?
Going to be a long three count.
What do you mean already? Like usually, like halfway through the show, I'm doing
those. That's true, but I'm usually able to edit most of them out.
I guess
I don't know how aware our listeners are.
Yeah, of how much I'm burping.
Your tendencies.
My Rick Sanchez in it. I think he's made it accessible and acceptable for me to
definitely
do so.
There's nothing people love more than just like people burping into microphones, people like eating food into microphones. Like these are the things that are going to sell your podcast.
Oh, I'm going to start doing the Dan Smart finger lick on our podcast.
Oh yeah, where he'd just like eat like an animal with his hands.
Yep, and then
just
like,
Yeah, he was like a real fucking like Guillermo del Toro movie monster type thing whenever he'd get... Start getting down on something that was a little bit drippy.
Love that fucking guy.
First shout out to Dan Smart, a longtime friend of ours. Recently follows us on Instagram. So he's getting our our wrestling updates now. So shout out to you. Sorry that you're seeing this stuff, because I know you're not really interested in it and you're just being polite by following us on the Instagram.
But I like that you have to look at it, too.
So, you know, props for being polite. Guy who's not going to hear this ever.
Like, I love that you want to be in our lives. And I like that as a consequence to that, you have to
Now you have to look at inside wrestling jokes that you don't understand.
Yep. Which is pretty, pretty cool. But our good friend, he's going to puke.
Mm-hmm.
He gets them.
That's
he's
right.
been giving us love.
He just gave us a shout out on Instagram we saw during our little break there.
So you follow
our
that
Instagram's
guy.
Instagram's blowing up. It's are you following up, us man. On Instagram? If you're listening to this and not following us on Instagram, what are you thinking? What's your life look like?
We got
How do you even tie your shoes when you leave your house?
We got a like from David Meltzer.
Yeah.
On Instagram. That's not a lie. That's not a lie.
Kansas City's own David Meltzer.
Correct. He's, on Instagram.
From what I understand, he's an accountant over there.
Well, you can't just cover wrestling for a living.
He's a real big wheel down at the Cracker Factory, and wherever he lives, this David Meltzer.
Nate, you remember a couple weeks ago when Flair came out after going the distance with Sting?
Yeah.
He was happy. He was celebrating.
He's still champion, man.
Yeah, because a win's a win, man, okay? It was David fucking Meltzer. A win's a win.
One of the hottest Instagram accounts on the whole service.
Yep.
That's what people are saying.
It's hard to get the Instagram followers when you're brand new because you're just starting.
Easier than it is on that Twitter, man. At least like you could post funny pictures on the Instagram and people are like, oh, I like that. I like that. Whatever. On the Twitter, you got to like convince people they're interested in what you're saying. And you know what? Nobody's interested in what anybody's saying unless you're a Kardashian or a Kanye. I'm telling you that right now.
It's hard to do.
Jump ship. Everybody get off Twitter.
What you're saying
I'm not updating Twitter anymore. Nobody be on Twitter.
It's hard to do without any kind of introduction.
Yeah, that's true. You can't just like cold open yourself out to the world and be like, hey, I'm a guy nobody's known of. Care about me. That doesn't work. That gets us into our three count oh so delicately. We were watching that Midnight Rider promo earlier, but the audio was fucked up on the WWE Network, and I was like, oh, what a terrible intro for a new character. I can't even hear what he's saying. So then I was thinking to myself,
from Diablo Canyon.
What are, conversely, some Colorado. Of the greatest intros of a new character I've ever seen? So this week we're talking character intro vignettes, those couple little bits of video they put together to introduce you to a new wrestler who's coming to the territory. He's going to be the new hot thing. Which are the ones that really, you know, got a guy over for you and let you think like, wow, this is a big deal. I'm so excited he's here. This is what we're talking about. This is our subject. This is our three count.
The Midnight Ride.
This is my own personal Vietnam.
If you will.
And I will. I will.
You will. You will, Daddy.
Let's get into it. Let's start talking about our threes, starting with our three, then going to our twos, and then going to our ones. That's how we're going to do it.
When Dusty couldn't be Dusty anymore, and he had to get himself over in a new way, he came up with the Midnight Rider.
Allegedly.
The Midnight Ride.
It's still playing itself out in our timeline. I'm not sure who he actually is.
So I want to turn to another guy who couldn't get himself quite off the ground. And he had to go elsewhere.
Mr. America.
Recreate himself as a new character.
Talking about Hogan's run as Mr. America.
No, as the Hulk machine.
Oh, that was a good one too.
Yeah. Had to reinvent himself, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And he did so with a series
I know where you're going.
Of amazing
this is
vignettes.
Just an attack on me is what you're doing right now.
I don't think so.
I think it's a personal attack on me.
Talking about from Big Dust
mm-hmm.
to Gold Dust.
Oh, you're talking about the intro of thought for a second you were going Repo Man.
Repo Man. Do you want to talk about those vignettes for a minute?
What do you got? What do you got about Repo Man? I thought for sure you were going
that kid over there.
Smash into
his
Repo
name
Man.
Is Adam Vargas. Why do I know this?
Why?
Because his father owes me a lot of money for that bicycle he's riding over there. And then Repo Man walks up to the little kid and steals his bike. And he's like, hey, kid, your dad's a deadbeat. And they show him just riding away on a child's bicycle.
That's really good.
Yeah, those Repo Man vignettes were awesome.
Once again,
and I struggled.
Once again, I've underestimated the Repo Man character.
He steals, like, several people's cars in the vignettes.
I just feel like you love the Repo Man too much.
He steals
too much.
A woman's station wagon out of her garage. And
I remember
she, like,
that
comes
one. I
out
specifically
and screams,
remember that one, yeah.
And he's just like, hey, cool it. You owe money. Uh-huh. And then just peels out.
Matter of fact, he's not wrong.
Okay, I'm sorry. All right.
He's just an asshole.
Repo Man, your honorable mention for me.
He's my number one.
But we're here to talk about gold dust.
Mm-hmm.
Those vignettes, man. Like, yeah.
Gold. It was dust. Weird.
It paved the way for what would become.
He was up in the Hollywood Hills, from what I remember. Or at least in front of a green screen in Connecticut, which had the Hollywood Hills projected behind him, probably.
It was weird. It was dirty. It was gritty. It was different. It was an alternate character.
Gay?
That's what a lot of people felt at the time,
okay,
yeah.
Yeah.
It was something different, though. And I feel like it really, you know, spearheaded what would become the Attitude Era.
I think he was wearing a golden top hat in those early ones, if I remember correctly.
Oh, I think you might be right.
Yeah.
I think like golden tuxedo. He still had like the wig.
It was weird. Talk about like a good way to get out from under your daddy's shadow. Yeah. Shadow of my daddy. My daddy with a big bullet of wood. How am I going to be a professional wrestler?
Nobody beats my meat.
My daddy was already dusty. Well, just fucking paint yourself up and be a complete weirdo and like don't even use your name and get over that way. And then, fuck, I did it on my own. I don't need you, daddy.
Yeah. Plus,
you hear me, daddy?
Just like Dugan, his dong was always readily visible.
Yeah, you're saying Dugan like Cowboy Bill Watts always used to when he was in Mid-South. Coming up next, Jim Dugan.
Yeah, you gotta say it right, man. I'm a traditionalist. Yeah. So Goldust, you get
Goldust did have visible dong a lot in those rompers that he would wear, those skin-tight pleather rompers.
It's like, he's not wearing nothing
under
there.
Not pleasant to look at, and I could get why Razor Ramon didn't want to wrestle him.
Ayo.
Who needs that?
I remember my first gig experience. Whoa, Vince. Your first? Razor gets
it. That's a story. That's a story that happened.
Razor gets it.
So, yeah, good establishing new character. Not the first time we'd seen the guy, but it seemed like we had. And suddenly, it was off to the races. Intercontinental Championships.
The racist? Which one of them was racist?
Off to the racist. That was the big feud he had with Roddy Piper, who famously painted himself half black that
one
time.
And he did it again against Goldust, which made no sense.
Oh, jeez. Roddy Piper. Hope you're learning a lesson down there in hell. You shouldn't have been so racist. My number three is
a lot of bubble gum and water.
A delightful little just short film, I feel like. I'm going to give it short film status. That signaled the debut of a new tag team coming to All Japan Pro Wrestling in 1985.
I'm familiar. It was like Fantastics.
It was a team.
Fantastics. Like that?
You're thinking of a different thing. That was Jim Crockett Promotions.
My mistake.
Debut of the Fantastics. This was when the Road Warriors first came to Japan.
Ooh.
First time ever. What they did was fucking crazy. They made a video where a UFO was orbiting the Earth, and then it came down and it crashed itself into some woods, and then out of the UFO came two aliens, who were the Road Warriors, who were a couple of beefy Midwestern dudes in jeans and windbreakers, because that's apparently what aliens look like.
What do you wear?
They walked a little bit through the woods, and then they found a dead deer, just a bloody dead deer corpse, and then a hawk started licking his lips. And then we had like a suggestive edit as if to say, these two aliens are now eating this deer.
Yeah.
Next scene, these two assholes are just like walking through a junkyard, like kicking stuff and knocking stuff over. It's like the scene in Gummo where the two kids are like, they come upon
the cowboys.
The kid with the rabbit ears, and they start saying,
I hate wabbits.
Wabbits are queers. They're basically doing that. They're having their Wabbits are queers moment. Just
the two little dusts.
But then,
Wabbits are queers, daddy, if you will.
What could happen is Paul Ellering finds them here in the junkyard, and he's got a raw chicken on him. So he lures them over to him with a raw chicken.
Nice.
Which he then tosses to them, which they
then
start eating.
It? Oh, they eat it.
Complete with footage of them having hunks of raw chicken hanging out of their mouths.
Oh, that's not smart.
At one point, you hear Hawk say, give me a fucking towel! I don't think that was supposed to be in the end. it was just a little bit of English that slipped in there. I don't think they really knew what he said there, but that's pretty funny. And then after that, Paul Ellering just like, you know, seduced the savage beasts with his raw chicken. Then he's got them, I guess, in the All Japan wrestling offices or something.
Give me a fucking tell.
Where he's showing his new finds off to people by having an animal put his hands through the drywall a bunch. Just palm thrust his hands through the drywall. And then it's over. And you're just like, wow, the Road Warriors are coming.
Yeah.
I'm pretty excited about this. They're aliens from another planet who eat raw animal corpses and can punch through drywall. Holy fuck. All of our tag teams are on notice.
Yeah, that's pretty strong. What year was that?
That was 1985. And just based on that, they were basically Japanese royalty for the rest of their lives. Could just waltz in and out of that country, wrestle for whatever promotion they wanted to at the top of the card, whenever the fuck they wanted to.
Because
they were aliens, man.
I guess a little bit still today, but up until like early 2000s, there was nothing Japan loved more than the American strongman.
Just a big, burly, strong white guy. Don't even got to be a good wrestler. If you're big and white and strong, we love you. And once you're over in Japan, you're over forever.
Yeah, like that's it. Like, done. Game over,
God bless
man.
Those people. You know, God's own creations. Salt of the earth.
Nate,
mm-hmm.
Would you call picnics fun?
Depends on the company, I guess.
I mean, like, would you want to talk about a picnic on wrestling?
Me and you, just like going on a picnic, it could be fun.
No, I'm saying, like, if you're watching wrestling, do you want to see somebody talking about picnics?
Usually not.
So probably not.
Probably not.
Just like mentioning things you eat at a picnic.
Is this like the video where the ant colony debuted in Chikara you're talking about? Did they come and steal somebody's picnic lunch and that's how they debuted?
That's a pretty good idea,
how
though.
They debuted in that promotion?
Well,
I haven't seen much Chikara in my day.
We should see if they can re-debut that team with
said maybe they'll finally get called up to the NXT.
Yeah.
We could send old Triple H an email.
So you don't really have much desire unless it's Chikara
and
the ant feud,
You know, the format of a wrestling television show, picnics do not seem like a very entertaining subject.
What if I get a guy in a Hawaiian shirt?
God,
and a bunch of prison tattoos.
Uh-huh.
Speaking in that weird kind of Kevin Costner southern accent. Just saying like, children eating hot dogs.
Yeah.
Fried chicken.
Weird talk about hot dogs.
Potato salad. It's a picnic.
This is scintillating.
Talking about.
Suddenly, I wasn't sold on the picnic idea, but I'm hanging on your every word right now.
Yeah. Usually it's boring, but there's one guy that can make it creepy, and he made it cool, and people are stealing his shit years and years later.
Look,
he was way too great for his time.
More Bray Wyatt than Bray Wyatt.
And I just got a bitchin' shirt from Shirtgun Wedding. I'm talking about my guy.
That company, Shirtgun Wedding?
They're on the Instagrams.
Okay,
that's where his shirt came
them.
From. I'm talking about Waylon Mercy.
Hello, you people. It's old Waylon Mercy again. As you can tell, I'm out here at the park, around the picnic area, waiting for all the people to come in. Surely after a while, they'll be out here with their children, with their fried chicken and potato salads and some hot dogs. Surely some hamburgers to go along with all that stuff. And the kids, they'll be running around here having a good old time. And then after a while, the kids will get on the parents' nerves, and the parents will start yelling and screaming, and then load up everything, put the children in the back daggum seats. Then they'll go home, and then they'll tell all their families and friends what a great time they had at the park and what a great picnic it was. Well, let me tell you something. Waylon Mercy knows how to throw a good picnic. And when I get into the ring in the WWF, I want to show you people what a picnic is all about. You know what I mean?
You talking about the Golden Boy, Dan Spivey?
No, he's dead.
Oh.
Long live.
It was a auspicious debut for his character, those vignettes, and then he went on to do many great things. Did we ever figure out why that character never became anything?
I don't know, man. It was like awesome. It was awesome.
Probably he got like taken down on drug charges soon after that or something.
Had to have been or something. Like he but was those on something vignettes during those promos. Were, there's the one in specific that I'm talking about.
Very
he's
mysterious.
Like
why is this guy talking about picnics? Yeah. Why is he wearing just like vacation togs?
And he's like, I'm going to show you all that life's a picnic. I'm going to invite you to my picnic inside the wrestling ring. And it's just like, oh, this guy's a little unhinged.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And again, this was in that early 90s where
like
it was
is
like
a cursed gimmick.
It's like, ooh, this is...
Waylon Mercy did a little bit about the mysterious, like, esoteric shitster. Sean O'Hare tried to do some of that stuff. Bray Wyatt tried to do it. All of them just jobbed out and forgotten immediately after these great vignettes that everybody loved and thought were, you know, the debut of the next big thing.
It's weird because clearly, I'm assuming Vince McMahon has a hard-on for Cape Fear and wanting Cape Fear to exist in wrestling.
The original. He still hasn't gotten around to the De Niro one.
Oh, goddamn, I'm talking about Robert Mitchum, pal. Mm-hmm. What's a De Niro?
It makes sense to me. It's probably one of the four movies that Vince McMahon has seen.
Yeah, and he calls that the new movie that he's seen. Should have worked. Should have worked, man.
I hear they came out with a remake of that Star Is Born. Yeah, it's a 1957 remake of that 1934 one. I'm real excited to watch it.
Right, I can't wait until 20 years from now when he finds that Streisand one.
Oh, God, Kris Kristofferson? It's going to blow his mind.
He's not ready.
No, he's not.
He's not ready.
My number two.
Are you ready?
Is the second tag team on my list. My list is very tag team heavy. And it's a little video that was letting everybody know that a new tag team called the Thrill Seekers were coming to the territory of Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
Ooh. Out on the back streets, I hear my heartbeat. Did it just say their name over and over again?
No. Once again, that was the fantastic Simpson Project promotions. You need to keep up.
I'm a little confused as to how you promote a tag team, Nate.
So you get a couple of pretty boy Canadians coming down to Louisville, Kentucky.
Is one of them Vampiro Canadiens?
No, not at this time.
Okay.
He was making legit money in Mexico.
Oh.
So Lance Storm, Chris Jericho, they're coming down. They're trying to sell them as the Thrill Seekers. This crazy, fun, blowjob, babyface, pretty boy tag team. What do you do?
It's really hard to do when one of them's Lance Storm, sir.
You put together a vignette of them out looking for thrills, man. Some Point Break-esque shit. What are they doing? Are they robbing banks and surfing? Are they jumping out of planes? No,
they're
not. Or
they're jerking each other off.
Because you're stuck in Louisville. So basically what you gotta do is you gotta go down to the local fun center and get as much fucking footage out of that thing as you can.
Yeah.
So you got some sort of lame hair metal rock song that sounds not like anything that shreds, something that sounds like it's off like the Bill and Ted soundtrack playing. Well, you show these two guys. Jericho is wearing some sort of like terrible suede Canadian fringe jacket, so you know he's a rock and roller.
Yeah.
Lance Storm's just wearing like a sensible winter coat.
Is he wearing?
And then also just big tiger stripe Zubaz.
Yeah.
And also he's got his fucking rat tail at the time. They
was,
both have their
Jericho,
dumb Canadian accents.
Is Jericho rocking the same suede fringe coat that Adam Duritz has in the Mr.
It's
Jones?
It's very similar video. To it, actually. It's Ooh, very. Nice. It might be the exact same coat. So you get footage of them playing some video games on the go-karts, doing a thing where they're wearing Velcro suits and jumping up against a Velcro wall.
Oh, God.
Buying plush Scooby-Doos from the ticket counter. All while you're trying to sell that, oh man, these guys are off the chain. These guys just love having a good time. Eventually, you get to the point where you reach the coup de grace of this selling these guys as adrenaline junkie fucking just maniacs. Get these guys out on Miami Beach and like have them doing shit, like having a lot of hot bikini girls, like
bungee jump,
looking
at least,
them
right?
up and down.
At least the bungee
or, like,
jump in
maybe
there.
Maybe you're in some sort of like nighttime club and they're like ordering bottle service and like all the waitresses can't get. No, no. You're gonna do a helicopter ride in Louisville, Kentucky in what seemed like a January afternoon. Because they're both just standing there waiting for the helicopter to take off in their winter coats, shivering in cold, forcing smiles while this fucking heavy metal song still plays. And then they like get on a helicopter and take a tour of the fucking bluegrass hillsides or whatever, because they're such fucking wild men who love having a good time so much. This thing is just dripping with nerdy, outdated, stale Jim Cornette just ideas of how the world works, and it's beautiful and it's weird and it's just like, once again, like a short movie all onto itself. It's like stumbling upon like a found snuff film is what it is. Like you buy a new spooky old house and you're going through like crawl space and you like pry up some VHS's. Boards and like, oh, what is falling apart 16mm film if I can project it? Oh, this is a terrible snuff film. No, it's just the Thrill Seekers debut in Smoky Mountain Wrestling.
Two quick stories.
Mm-hmm.
The Velcro, the jumping into the Velcro wall thing.
It looked like a lot of fun.
They used that in a TGIF episode. I can't remember. I'm struggling in my head.
I'm going to show you how it's done. I know. TGIF.
It was in the Family Matters.
Standing tall. That was the Balky one.
No. It was the Perfect Strangers. It was either Perfect Strangers, Family Matters, or
the newspaper page.
Step by Step.
Love and Condition on the Grand Design.
It was one of those three shows.
Oh, Patrick Duffy the Vampire Slayer was on that show.
Day by day. And then my other point was
Oh, because the opening of that show, the credits were them at, I believe, Cedar Point. Yeah, it was just footage of them like, it was something on the coast.
Yeah.
I don't know why I went to Cedar Point.
Might have been Kings
Island. Some sort of roller coaster thing. Either way, it was a big helicopter shot when they were panning out at the end, though, because they were all on a roller coaster. And then you panned out and you realize, the roller coaster's right next to a big body of water. What a beautiful, strangely majestic shot to just go into this weird, studio
awesome
set
show.
Sitcom.
I mentioned bungee jumping when you were talking about thrill seeking.
Yeah.
When I was real young, like 10 or 12, it was like when bungee jumping was first getting cool in the 90s.
I remember that when it was getting cool. Yeah. Like, have you heard about this bungee jumping?
Have you seen people bungee jump?
An earlier version of like, there's news stories being like, have you heard about these rave parties where kids are taking a drug called ecstasy? Have you heard about this bungee jumping where people are jumping off of things
really
while attached to bungee?
This is really a thing.
Oh, yeah. 60 Minutes covered it. I'm certain of it.
We were on one of our yearly trips to Michigan, and my old man and I.
What a privileged life you led.
As we cross a bridge known as the Mighty Mac, we find it. Something the Ojibwa call Gagige. We know it as timeless. A land that says, slow down. Listen to my stories. Hear my songs. Timeless can be as big as a sunset on a great lake, or as endless as the stars that watch over us. Welcome to Michigan's Upper Peninsula. Welcome to the purest of pure Michigan.
This is the only place we went on summer vacation.
Nobody likes a bragger.
Yeah, my old man and I were walking along the shore there or whatever, where the docks, the pier.
You
I
guys
guess
doing
that's
like Rocky and Apollo stuff,
yeah,
like
a little
running
bit.
On the beach.
A little bit. And we came across a bungee jump. They had like a crane with the bungee jump thing.
Very exciting.
And we saw what she seemed older at the time, but like looking back on it now, she was probably like 19, 20. And she was in like some kind of short skirt.
Still seems too old for me. You know what I'm saying,
bro?
Hell yeah, dog.
Hell yeah. And she bungee jumped. And I can remember clear as day her coming to the very bottom of the rope to where it starts to spring up.
Uh-huh.
And then that's when she started peeing. And you can see all the pee coming out and just falling into the lake.
Sorry if my boner hitting the bottom of the table got picked up on the mic.
And
right
I'm starting
that's
to
unprofessional
realize
of me.
That's probably where my fascination with, you know, those pee videos on the internet started.
They're
you know?
Everywhere.
Yeah. So a little look behind the curtain there.
Look behind the meat curtains.
Vagina.
19-year-old pee all over my face. Oh. What is it going to do? Frasier has left the building.
Oh, Frasier, you done it again, man. Oh, we're at the end of this list. Thank Jesus.
Have you done your Number one.
Here it comes, buddy. Okay. I'm not even going to give it much fanfare because it's just the greatest introductory promo of all time. It's Mr. Fucking Perfect, man.
I knew you were going with that one. It's I knew you were, because I know how much you love Mr. Perfect.
We've talked about it on the show before. It's just, it was the coolest fucking thing. Like, when I was a little kid, like, I wanted to do all those things he could do. I spent a whole Saturday practicing the gum swat thing, the fucking towel behind your back,
Saturday's
all of it.
Saturday's a big day, too. That's one of your only days. You don't have to go to school.
I was willing to give it away just so I could do that shit. And it was worthwhile, because I still swat my gum till this day. Him fucking hitting dingers, fucking throwing up the no look three pointers.
That guy could throw a pass and then catch a pass.
Right,
with
and it
a pig
all
skin.
Culminated to whatever Jackson, Deion Jackson, or whatever the fuck his name was from the Vikings. Who cares?
Hi, I'm Steve Jordan of the Minnesota Vikings. Some people say that Warren Moon is a great passer. Around these parts, they say that Fran Tarkenton is the greatest. I want to introduce you to the perfect passer.
That's right. I am the perfect passer, and I understand you're the perfect tight end.
He's like, hey, go long. I'm going to throw you a couple passes. And like, he's like, oh, man, this Mr. Perfect dude's got an arm. And he's like, oh, you think so? Check this out. Whips the ball, stands there for 2 seconds, then starts running.
Very cocky.
And still effortlessly throws a 120-yard pass to his fucking self, and it's all in slow motion, so you know that it's real.
He's the perfect athlete.
It's all in slow motion, so you know it's real. I did it right,
yeah, exactly.
Dude.
That's
like Mr. Perfect.
That's how filming things with cameras works.
People say greatest to never win the title, you know?
He didn't need it.
I know.
He didn't need the title.
I know, but it's like, he's perfect, so he should have had it.
He had it in my heart.
You'll be in my heart. You know I like to bring it Phil Collins whenever I can.
You know not to sing Phil Collins me when I still have a number one to
talk
about.
Because
now
right.
I'm up here in my head just thinking about the past and thinking about lost loves and all this stuff.
Oh,
and how am I going to get through this three count? So I knew you were going to do that for your number one. There was no question in my head.
Sorry those cheetahs
so I did not
put
that for my number one. Instead, I went for the number two all-time greatest entry, video, introduction, vignettes of all time. And those were the ones that turned a man previously known as Ted DiBiase into the million-dollar man. These ones were great because basically, they just used all rich guy Vince McMahon's shit to make it seem like Ted DiBiase was rich. They had him like hanging out in his fucking mansion, which was just like a kind of shoddy Connecticut mansion, and like just riding around in a limo. And he's always doing shit where he was paying people off to get special treatment. There was one where he paid off a guy in charge of a public pool to kick all the little kids out of the pool.
I specifically remember that.
And then he was laying in his lawn chair, and all the little kids had to be on the other side of the fence looking through, like staring at him, and he wasn't even using the pool anymore. He was just sitting next to it, and they couldn't swim anymore.
How hard do you think Vince was laughing when they filmed that?
Vince wasn't there.
No, he was there.
There's no way.
He was
Vince
there.
Vince was on location for a shoot. There was another one where they were in a fancy restaurant and he's skipping the lines and then like, you know, everybody's like, hey, buddy, we were in line before you. And he's like,
go fuck
yourself. You think you were in line before me? Talk to Virgil.
Yeah.
And Virgil would step up and like bow up and they'd be like, ew, we're here in Connecticut and this, he's got a black man with him.
Yeah.
We didn't want any trouble, pal.
Like, that's what they were intimidated by, because he's like half the size of DiBiase.
There's another one where he's counting his money, and he gets a paper cut counting his money. So then he goes to the hospital, and he's paying the nurse to get him ahead of all the people with serious injuries just to get a Band-Aid on his paper cut.
We got to ask Davey R. Scheister what that's like.
Absolutely. What is it like to be rich? He was letting us know. And the good things about him weren't just that, you know, it was out on location and showing him being a rich asshole and showing him being privileged. It was the way DiBiase sold it, because he always let us know, like, he wasn't just like, ha ha ha, I'm the king, I'm so rich. He was always just like, hey, there's no bad guys here. This is the way the world works.
Yeah.
I'm rich, so I get what I want. These people who I'm paying to let me do this, they're not doing anything that you wouldn't do.
Yeah, they need
you
this money just like you do.
You would do the same thing. This is how the world works. You know that you're not better than this.
Yeah.
Just don't be mad at it. Everybody has a price. Everybody's compromised. Everybody's imperfect.
That's a great point, man.
And I'm talking about you, and I'm talking about all your insecurities.
Yeah.
which I'm above, because I am rich and you are not.
You're not mad at me, you're mad at the system,
there
bro.
There was no counter argument you could have, because you watched this and you knew in your heart, if he was laying down hundo after hundo after hundo of Vince McMahon's money to try and pay you off to screw somebody else over, you'd go for it, because it's a dog-eat-dog world out there, and we're all trash on the inside.
Right. At least somebody was getting paid.
A dirty mirror showing us that we're all trash on our inside.
Yeah, at least somebody's getting paid.
So many layers of this character. I want to hate him, but he's not wrong.
You can't.
He's just an asshole.
Yeah. Where we got next week?
Next week, we got a big Halloween episode coming up. But that's not next week. That's the week after that.
Oh, okay. Well,
so next week,
what's next week?
Theoretically, we're at Primetime Wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
That would be April 18th, 1988 episode of Primetime Wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
Unless I want to just be like, I'm going to do two Halloween episodes and fuck our regular thing.
We really do love Halloween.
I might do that. I love Halloween. So it's a little bit up in the air. It might be Primetime Wrestling. I might come up with two ideas for Halloween episodes.
Ooh.
Do you think I should? It's crazy.
I know. I love Halloween.
It's crazy. I know.
You know, I'm right there with you.
I've got like 3/4 of the ideas to just do two Halloween episodes.
So
I've already sold myself on it. We're not going to Primetime Wrestling.
Yep.
It's going to be another Halloween.
Oh, lay it on me.
Or let's do Halloween Havoc 1990.
We're
watching Halloween Havoc 1990.
Eric Bischoff said Halloween Havoc was their WrestleMania.
There's no better way to sell it than that, Eric Bischoff said.
So be sure to fucking check that out next week on Baby Oil and Blow. And remember, stay single.